Hi there, and welcome to a video outlining genetic inheritance. So genetic inheritance is a way that we track the way traits are passed from individual through the generations, through families. So we can use kind of a fairly simple letter system, although we're finding out it's a lot more complex than that. But we can at least use that to kind of have a starting point so we can track the movement of these genes and how it's inherited over time. So the genotype refers to the actual genes that are inherited. And just a reminder with genes, those are, if you have your chromosome here, that is a segment of the chromosome where a particular set of adenines, guanines, cytosines, and thymines, or ATCs and Gs, are found. So the ATCs and Gs are throughout the chromosome itself, but we can find specific sequences that are actually meaningful. So if we were to start, for example, like say in the middle here and go somewhere else, it may not code for anything, but if we started a very specific start point and a very specific endpoint, that will actually make a protein that is then translated into some sort of expressed trait, which I'll get into in a moment. And so that part is called the gene, and we've had to do sequencing and then track that to see what right ATC and G combination leads to a specific gene expression or a gene that we can see. So genes that are inherited. So typically we use a letter system, and I'm just going to use kind of an artificial system here. So we have, remember, you get a gene from your mother's side and a gene from your father's side. So your sets of chromosomes, half comes from the mother's side, half comes from the father's side. We're not going to worry about crossing over or anything like that right now. And so we just use simple letters. We don't want to write out the whole ATC and G combination because that's thousands of bases long. The ATCs and Gs would be many, many. So we just use letters as a shorthand method to track which gene that is and what it means. So that's the letter part. Now the phenotype part are the physical traits. And so what you need to do when you're kind of tracking these problems to outline this, physical traits. What we need to do there is to make sure that we align each letter with an actual trait. So we could say that the capital G is prefers green chili. So I'm living in New Mexico. That is a very big deal here, what you prefer for most people. And then the small g would be prefers red chili. Again, this is kind of an artificial system I'm making up here. Most inheritance patterns are very complex, but we do start with this kind of beginning overview to see that first step in how things are passed through the generations. And then the fact is there's usually other genes that come into play that control the expression. We're not going to get into that level of detail, but just to have something to start with to track the traits. And the allele refers to different forms of a gene. So for this particular example here, the gene, I would say, codes for chili preference. We're not saying what, it just codes for chili preference. The allele types are red or green. Now, if there were other chili types you wanted to put in there, you could have other alleles. So, but we're just going to stick with red or green here. And then you have what's called a dominant allele. So this is the allele that sort of overrides the expression of the other. And it's typically specified by a capital letter. And recessive is typically specified by a lowercase. So in this example here, it would be the G, the lower G. Lowercase g. So what you're saying is if you have an individual that has an upper and lowercase, so they have a green chili and a red chili allele type, the physical outward trait that you're going to see is going to be a green chili preference in this particular example. So what we can do is we can set up Punnett squares, and Punnett squares can track the likelihood that certain traits will be passed down. So this is kind of a fun example here that we're using, but if we were looking at a disease allele, for example, it would be extremely important to predict the likelihood that that would be passed down to the next generation. You would need to know if that's a dominant or a recessive allele as well. So I could take, let's say I'm gonna use the symbol here, the mother's side, and I'm gonna put, I'm gonna make her what's called heterozygous. So that's another term we can define. So they have one of each allele type, or maybe we could say two different alleles. The other possibility is homozygous. Now keep in mind there's some traits that can have more than two alleles, so we don't want to say it's going to contain all of those, but it would have two different alleles. Homozygous has just one allele type. They still have two of them, but only one type. So an example I could use here would be the red chili phenotype, which would be little g, or the green chili phenotype, which would be capital G, capital G. And in this case, it would be, for heterozygous, it would be this one here. So that would be the possibilities that can be passed on into her ovum as she, that will go into the zygote that's there. So we'll pick for the father, we'll pick that he's going to have a red chili preference, and so he's going to be homozygous. Combine those together. So what you do, oh, I forgot this part. Little symbol just to remind us it's the father's type. We do that to just, again, just kind of bookkeeping to track which parent we're talking about. So remember, the father's making sperm, the female's making ova, and so those are the two different possibilities she can make. When you make the gametes, the egg or the sperm, those cells only get one of each type because we have the amount of genetic information so that when the zygote is formed, when fertilization occurs, you still get back up to the normal amount. So possibilities would be for offspring, and we typically just write the capital letter first. It's not critical, but if you kind of keep that same system, it's just visually a little bit easier to see where your same sets are. So this one would make a heterozygote, homozygote, heterozygote, homozygote. So what we would say is there's 50% or one half are GG. And this is where it really helps to have a nice key, because a lot of times you'll get here and you'll think, wait, what does that mean again? So you can go back up. These are the red chili prefers. And then 50% are heterozygous, and they are in this case GG, and those prefer green chili. Keep in mind the homozygous dominant combination would have given you that same phenotype as well. We just didn't have that possibility that showed up here. So that's basically it. Probably the biggest challenge with these problems is really just that sort of keeping track and keeping organized. So having a clearly defined letter system and then defining what they mean. Because once you get that, it's fairly easy to set that up and do the box and get the ratios. But sometimes you'll get these great setups in here and then you forget what the letters mean. So that's where a good key helps you there as well. Okay, that's all I have for Punnett squares. They can get a lot more complex with alleles for other traits as well. So this is just the very simple kind of starting Punnett square to work with getting you set that up. Thank you very much. This is Corey Andres for CNN.